A very good afternoon to you all, and a warm welcome to the virtual masterclass series presented by the Yongsu To Conservatory of Music. Today's session is the latest installment of the conservatory's masterclass series, which the conservatory has run for its students and the wider music community for over 17 years. Through these masterclasses, our students are given the invaluable opportunity to learn from some of the world's finest musicians. In recent years, these visiting artists have included Nobuko Imai, Gautier Capuçon, Andras Schiff, and Masaki Suzuki. The Conservatory is glad to be able to continue its tradition of presenting its masterclass series, which continues to evolve in response to the COVID pandemic. Today, we welcome a live audience, as well as a virtual audience joining us on YouTube. We are greatly privileged to have with us today Professor Christopher Vengjin. Mr. Vengjin is the founder and honorary president of the Joseph Joachim International Violin Competition in Hanover. Mr. Vengjin served as concertmaster of the Hanover State Opera and Philharmonic Orchestra for many years and is currently the vice president of the University of Music, Drama and Media, Hanover. Welcome, Professor Vengjin.
Hi, good morning, good afternoon, and good evening, wherever you are, all over the world. I'm very happy to be today with you.
We're happy to have you here as well. Well, today, Professor Vengjin will be working with students from the Conservatory's violin studio. We'll begin with fourth-year student Tian Jing, who will perform Hu Bai's Carmen Fantasy, accompanied by second-year pianist So Wei Ti.
Wonderful. So, I understand we are going straight to our first performer. And just at the beginning, I would like to tell you that is also first time for that kind of public masterclass for me. So we are all of us very, very excited. And I keep crossed fingers for everybody and for myself also. So let's go to our first performer with Hu Bai. Carmen Fantasy. And of course, I will not stop you, my dear. So you play from the very beginning to the very end, and then we'll talk a little about, and if necessary, we'll work also a little bit about, okay? So good luck. Thank you.
Thank you.
Can you hear me? Can you hear me? Yeah, great. So congratulations, bravo. So that was really very, very, very well done, Carmen. You know, I enjoyed a lot of things, a lot, your huge temperament and the kind of, not everywhere, but in a way you are very accurate player. So what can we do today? I think we should maybe work a little bit on sophistication. Do you know the word sophistication? Could you speak a little bit louder, because I cannot hear anything.
Yes.
Ah, yeah, great. So maybe our technicians can put on a little bit your voice. So I think, you know, we could start to think about how are we going to plan, in fact, that kind of piece, because the piece is extremely emotional. Yeah. So we are starting already. Do you remember the dynamic of the beginning of the piece?
Forte.
What is the dynamic?
Forte?
Yeah, exactly. It's forte, but it's not more than one forte. So that's why I'm talking about that, because you are extremely emotional straight from the very, very beginning, and you are keeping on the whole introduction, apart maybe of two or three bars, everything between fortissimo and triple forte. So I think we could be a little bit, we could start maybe not more with that, but, you know, having possibility to go up and, of course, to go down. That possibility we have in your playing always, almost always. But I would like you, you know, to be a little bit like at the beginning, like you would stand next to yourself and listen to the person. Of course, it's fantastic to be the person. Of course, you are Carmen. But at the beginning, I would like you not to exaggerate, you know? And for example, we have that fantastic, it is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. In the seventh bar of your introduction, you have that wonderful scale going up. Don't you think that would be very good idea maybe to use that to arrive in piano? So, you know, not to keep everything so tense, yeah? Mm. So let's have a look, what can we do? How can we get that a little bit lighter in a way? Okay, not so bombastic, okay?
Okay.
Let's have a look. Come on, let's start, and I will stop you. I don't know if it is possible with those technical possibilities, but I will stop you something like after 10 bars or something like that, okay?
Okay.
So let's go. Come on. Okay, great, wonderful. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. So look, another small idea. Maybe don't start that very first note to vibrate before you get the tone. Because this time it happened that it was not anymore E. That is, you know, you are going to, it's such a huge vibrato. Would be nice to get, you know, first note, and then immediately, of course immediately, but first very, very clean E. Mm. Okay, E or me, whatever, so me that word used. Okay, one more time, come on. Okay, very good. Excellent. The same story. You know, you started now you started vibrato before you got the note. So remember about that, because otherwise you are not playing out of tune, but it seems to be out of tune. You know? Okay. So you know, I would like to encourage you when you land on that to have already piano on that note. And you know, I think you did it, or maybe it is just my imagination, but I think you did it now a little bit more appealing because you used more colors. Even on internet, I can, maybe it is more imagination than fact on the internet, but because you are using different dynamics. And then second time. So in fact, we have always two bars, small parts of sentence. Yeah. So I would make difference. I would do that like you did it now. Okay. And then of course, when you're coming to G string, you can get back to that forte or, but no more than forte. Because you know, everything is in front of us. We are opening that, so we need to have, in a way, reserve going up and going down. So I would like to encourage you to use the whole scale, especially when you play the piece without orchestra. When you play that with piano, you can be a little bit richer in the scale of dynamic. Okay, for the last time, come on and stay up there. When you are going to C sharp, stay up there in piano, okay? And then coming back on G string to forte. One more time, go on. Excellent, wonderful. Okay, thank you very much. Your name is Xie, yes?
Sorry.
What is your name?
You can call me Jing. Jing.
Jing. Jing.
Yes.
Jing. Okay. So it's a first name. It's not a surname, yeah?
It's my nickname.
Nickname. Very good. Excellent. Jing. So look, we finished in a way the first part here. Now, I would like you, when you finish that here, to use a little bit more vibrato, not very broad, but more vibrato on small notes. So not only and then, you understand the way? So, a little bit more intimate, okay? Can you try to make that more intimate? And maybe that would be a good idea because you are playing, you are using here full bow, yeah? So in the way from here. I don't think it's such a good idea. You know, you could change in the air and to have more bow, to organize more bow, and very light and fast bow for the main note, for second C sharp. Okay? Can you start from the C sharp on the top? Da-dum. Okay, that's not that easy, yeah? Okay, let's do it only. Okay, and now use that pause in the air for changing place of the bow, yeah? Okay, directly from from the last note. Okay, wonderful. Very, very good. Very good. You know, entering those octaves, I don't think we change the character of music here. We think it is so important because we play octaves and we have problem, mental problem with octaves, yeah? Or we think, oh God, I have to play octaves and that it will be probably out of tune, or hopefully it won't be out of tune. But the music is not that complicated. You play ti ta 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 dum, extremely long, preparing next triplet ti ta ta ti dum. I don't think it's the music, you know. I think the music is as easy as here. Yeah. So I wouldn't stay so long on those objects. I wouldn't make the big thing out of that. Okay. So maybe it's not necessary to repeat. You understand the idea. Okay, and now we are entering our cadenza. Let's go from your cadenza, yeah? From here, okay? Come on. Okay, Chin, look, that is exactly the same as we spoke about octaves. The melody is. And that's it. That is, of course, with thirds or with double stops, but melody is much easier and in a way lighter. Can we start from here? Okay, so you have problems with your earphones. Okay, come on. Yeah, I don't understand your rhythm. Just a second. I don't understand rhythm. Rhythm is look. Not one, two. One, two. Yeah, okay, one more time. Okay. Okay, can you hear me? No, because I was kicked out. Look, I was just asking you, did you notice where the orchestra is giving you? The orchestration is giving you place for freedom, where you play with orchestra, where you are dependent and where you are independent. If you have a look, you will see that always you have. When you play that, You can play however you want. You can take a little bit more time because nobody is waiting. Nobody is disturbing or nobody is trying to help. However, whatever of verb you are using here, yeah? Okay, come on. So take, you know, take freedom of being free where it is absolutely possible and reasonable. Okay, one more time from bottom la. Okay, thank you very much, Jim. You know, especially when I have that possibility to listen to you on internet, I hear very clear, and now be careful, try to understand, I hear very well what I don't hear. So you have many notes which are just touched and you think you played them, but it is not really clear. Those notes are not clearly here. And that thing, that problem, that is not a big problem because you have to be in charge of your own control. You have to be the person who is taking care of that. I hear with in the left hand, do I really bring it with my right hand? Yeah, so that is usually connected to bow and sounding point and contact, etc., etc. Not exclusively, but usually. So have a look in the whole piece because that problem is coming later even more. So that we have situations where you play, but I don't know what you play. Of course I know the piece, so I can help myself. But you know, you are playing usually not for musicians. You are playing usually, your general audience is not built out of musicians. So they cannot think that what you thought that you play, yeah? So I would like you to be a little bit more precise. And now because you know the time is running like crazy, and I'm sure we will not get into the end, I just wanted to tell you some things, some small observation now in that part of Carmen which is coming, you know? Try not to overpower, try not to you know, to kick so many notes when you play ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta- time, it's better quality, you know. And then I think we have here one very interesting rhythmical situation in the piece. And I would like to encourage you to play that really strictly in rhythm. So that is. So 1, 2, 3, ya papa, 1, 2, 3, one ta ta tam, wa pa pa pam. So I don't think it is really placed for rubato. So if you could, after all those cadenzas, you know, after all those gymnastic of the violin, and you are going up and down, and then suddenly absolutely strict and extremely, I would almost say, noble. Okay? Can we try to get that whole part of the piece, yeah? Okay, from Allegro. Okay, very good. Just a second. Excellent. Did you notice that you are totally alone playing that?
Yeah, I know.
Well, so take time wherever you need. That's the first thing. Wherever you need, take time. And think about how to present that to audience that they would say, oh, wow. You know, and not, I shouldn't get an idea that it is difficult. If I'm coming out, going out from the concert and telling, wow, she played a difficult program. So it's not the most fantastic comment, I think, you know? I don't want to be part of difficulties as a listener, okay? One more time. So take time wherever you need that. Go on. Okay, I'm sorry. That is not true what you play. You are not really in those three. No, in fact, three bars only. You can do accelerando, but don't cut out the long notes, you know, long notes. And when I use the phrase take time wherever you need, I don't mean play slower. I don't mean at all to play slower. I mean, we have situations when it's of advantage for you as a player and also for me as a listener to have, you know, yum, pam, 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 pam. Yeah? So situation like this one, where it is of advantage for the piece, for the situation, for everybody involved to have a little bit more time. Okay? So think about that and, you know, check all those passages going down. If it is really absolutely up to your expectation, the standard, yeah? Mm. Very good. Come on, let's go to Habanera. Okay, very good.
Excellent.
Very good, very good, very good. Could you be a little bit more in charge of control of the quality when you are entering your flageolets? You are using a lot of bow and you are not able to control that bow. So maybe with a little bit less bow would be very good. And you know, once when you play that, so that is, if you want to miss any note, you can miss any note, but please not that one. That note is not to be missed, okay? One more time, come on. Habanera. Okay, thank you very much. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Look, you played very, very well, and then you land in that situation where you have. And what are you doing? You are going to the very top of the bow, and you are doing something, but who knows what is it? Nobody knows. I would like to have. So. I wouldn't go so high, because as higher you are, as more difficult is your control. And in fact, we would like to have that effect of castagnetti, takatakatam, takatakatam. So I would like to have all those notes. Can you play for me only those notes, please? Takatakatam, pam, pam. Can I have better quality of sound? Come on. So. Come on. Yeah, and you know, we are sometimes doing too much with that up bow. That is not so energetic. Yeah, come on. Almost. We have those castagnetti, very good. But that one not so good. Come on. And you know, just for your, just that you know that we doing that down bow, we are doing usually huge diminuendo, yeah, and then we are kicking much, very much the fifth note. So. In fact, he wrote that five together, but that is another subject. So, not too much, okay? That should be better. Come on, let's try. And slightly more bow for last, for the fifth note. Slightly more bow, slightly more. Yeah? Okay, so that will be, and now you know, now you can do that. I see already Alison, who is going probably to tell us that time is over, but just
a 3.5 minutes left.
So, oh my gosh, we are extremely precise. 3.5 minutes, okay, come on. So I would like you now to play that melodic takatakatam pam, takatakatam pam, pam, and be careful, watch to land in the proper place of the bow for that place, okay. Can we start maybe? Pam pam pam. So, yeah, exactly. Go on. Okay, very good, Jean. That is very, very beautiful. And you took now somehow advantage of being alone. Exactly, even more freedom in that. And the last small detail for today. You know the difference when you play flageolets, pam pam pam, and then when you play octaves, ta dam pam pam. It's as I sang the first time. The composer wrote dots. So pam, short, 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 and with octaves, it's not that short. It will be, you know, it will be bigger. It will be more important. It will be, you know, it will be more theater. And that is the last sentence of me of today. Please try to behave as a real Carmen and the whole situations in the opera. So even using your face, even sometimes smiling, sometimes being sad. So you are in person in charge of that, in charge of bringing the drama to us. So if you are really sincere in doing that, what you do, and I think you are, so show that a little bit more also. And don't be scared about, you know, small things. It will be, if not today, then tomorrow will be as you want, okay? So, thank you very much. It was a great pleasure. But of course, we didn't do that much. But maybe someday, somewhere in the world, we can do more. Okay? So, thank you so much. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
Thank you, Professor Wang Jin. And thank you, Tianjing, We now welcome third-year student Zhou Meng, who will play the fugue from Bach's Violin Sonata No. 2 in A minor. Zhou Meng, please.
Is this okay, very good. Okay. Alison?
We're all good to go.
Okay, great, very good. So, first of all, congratulations. You did it very, very well. The only thing which I'm a little bit skeptical, you know, is when people play by music, not by memory. So I always think automatically. I think, however good or bad is the person, I think if it was like that when you played the way that you were more reading than playing, because we have only 100% of our possibilities, yeah, of our concentration. And then we spend a lot for reading things which you know by memory, I think almost backwards. So I would like to encourage you when you performance to do it always by memory. Then you are better concentrated, you can better to decide how you play, not what you play. We know that, you know. You know that, me know that, and a lot of people watching, they also know that. So we don't need to check if you play right text. So that is only on the, you know, on the back of my head, what I was thinking when you were playing that by music. Look, I would like to ask you something. Or maybe even different way. Could you tell me something about that fuga? Could you tell me something about the style? Could you tell me something? How do you want to build that big monument like that fuga? So what are your intentions here? So we are, okay, I start for you. We are in Baroque time, and now go on. What would you like, how would you like to perform that? Can you verbalize that what you did? You know what I mean? We are, you can start, okay, so I'm playing solo piece that is from the solo sonata of Bach, the composer of Baroque time. So the Baroque music is, and now blah, 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 like that. So how I would like to make that? Tell me one, two sentences about fuga, and then how are you going to make that readable and hearable for everybody of us?
Fuga, it has many voices, and it has one main theme, the motif, and so that all voices combine together.
They are sweet. Okay, many voices. What does it mean, many voices? How many? 10, 20, 2? How many voices?
I don't know.
Very good. So then you have to research. Okay, you have to research that. How many voices do we have in those three fugas? They are not so different from each other, especially G minor and A minor are very, very, very similar. That is just variation because G minor is, and the other one is only differently, you know, with variation, yeah? But in fact, so that was the theme, yeah? So, and that theme goes from voice to voice, and that's why that is name is fuga. Fuga, what does it name? What does it mean, fuga? You know, by the way, what does it mean, fuga, in English?
Not really English.
Okay, so fuga comes from fugare, from Italian word, but in English it means escape. Yeah, so, or in German, Flucht. So it means the one theme in one voice is running away and the other one is running behind in another voice. The same theme in another voice, and then in another voice. So one time it is in one voice, in two voices, or even like in G minor, we have moments where we have four voices. You know, here it is every second note. It's not like in G minor, but so that is, and then we come to the so-called harmonic cadenza, which ends up one of small parts of fuga, and then we go to that so-called intersection. Yeah, okay. So, but that is of course necessary to know. I think it would be much easier for you to play if you know. But you are playing instinctively. It is quite clear what you do. It is very clear. What is not clear, many many times you are producing, you know, I call that for my students a noise between the notes. So because we have twang, so it is a lot, you know, we are touching strings, we are not doing really very, very clear the bow work. But it is also something else what I wanted to ask you. What is the difference? You know, we have usually, I have to be very careful not to tell you already the answer, but we have in fuga, in that fuga, but not only in fuga, in any of movements of sonatas, solo sonatas or partitas, we work usually with detaché and legato. Yeah? Mm-hmm. Those are two main articulations, detaché and legato. So can you tell me any specific things about legato? How are we going to play legato? Because when you started, I thought you are very, very well informed about that, because in a way you played that the way which I thought, okay, he is trying to play Baroque way. A little bit of Baroque way, but as further you went, as more and more unclear it was, and that you ended up almost in romantic legato. So the question is, my dear, the question from Europe to you, what is the difference between romantic and Baroque legato, or upside down, Baroque and romantic legato?
Baroque has release every bow. Baroque style has release in every bow.
Yeah, what does it mean every bow? I'm quite specific, and that will help you. We have three legato. So you call that release. Which note is release? In three legato. Sir.
You mean the first three notes?
No. I mean when we have... So I'm playing D major scale in Baroque three legato. By the way, Baroque and classical legato is the same. So you did proper answer. We are releasing every bow. What does it mean, every bow? We are releasing every legato. It means the first note is heavy and the last note is released or phrased or shortened, however you describe that. So when you play, for example, so could be Baroque, yeah, it's classic, but it means the last note, because we play two legato, the last note is shortened, it's released. If you play three legato, the third note. When we have six legato, what you did, fantastic. You play, yeah? And you release that. Mm-hmm. But then, in the second, third, fourth page, you were less and less releasing. So you play. So it will give you that kind of language, because Baroque is a different language. So we are, thanks God, in the time now that we have almost for every composer own language, not talking about epochs. Of course, we have different language for Baroque, for Classic, for Romantic. So I would like to try to encourage you to use that, knowledge, and to try to be absolutely clear. And coming back now to fuga, when we know that is the word means escape, so to run away, it gives us also, in a way, the information about character. Because if we are running away, we are not playing because something is difficult. We think it's difficult for the left hand. But look, isn't it funny that we are playing piece from the 18th century, so that is more than 300 years ago, and everything is better in the world during those 300 years. So I suppose violinists are also better. Of course we are much better, but those people played that 300 years ago. Okay, you can say they had another bridge, they had another violins, they had another bows, Baroque bows, but still they played that. So we know everything. You know, the research goes on since 70 years or almost 100 years. So we know much, much more than our, you know, fathers, and I mean, I could be your grandfather even. So you know already much more, or you should know already much more than myself, yeah? And I know much more than my teachers. So we should be able to use our knowledge and to put that into our performance. So now I would like to ask you, you know, we will not start for the moment from the beginning. I would like to ask you to play for me those legati. We will find out places with legati. We don't have them so many, but those that we have, we will try to make that, you know, that kind of, as you call that, releasing, okay? Mm-hmm. So when you have, for example, okay, so that will be one of those places, and the other one, but maybe let's start from the easiest one. Let's start from here. Can you start? That is bar number 206. Okay, come on. Quite huge music. Yeah, come on. Very good. Excellent. Very good. And now, you know, if you feel that some harmony is more important for you than the others, show it more. You tried to do that, but it is not really very clear. But if you think, well, oh, that's changed, that, you know, that, how do you call it? The changing of tonality is very important for me. Show that more, okay? So you can take tararam, papapapatiraram, papapapatiraram. So wherever you think it's appealing for yourself, then one day we will talk about that, what is appealing for the structure. That is another subject. But now we are going from that instinctive play, yeah? With our instinct. So make that instinctive, but don't be shy. Don't think that you are doing too much, okay? If it will be too much, we will let you know about that by email, okay? Come on, once more. Come on. Very good, very good. And You told me that you are releasing last note, what is absolutely perfect. But what does it do with the time if we are releasing? If I play last note shorter, so is it the invitation to start? No, of course not, because if we do that, so it is counterproductive. So it is exactly, well, we did something good and we destroyed that immediately, you know? So remember about that. And also you can from time to time think about where are you going to? For example, at the end. So I don't think you know that just that you should just pass by. We are not passing by that many places. Yeah? So give me information, okay, we are arriving somewhere, and then will be the total change of character. Yeah? Okay, so that was one of those legato places. Can you play for me the other one, which I just started? That was here, yeah? So. Okay, that is bar number, my dear, 104. Okay. Okay. Thank you very much. Before we enter our legati, don't you think that we need a little bit more time for chords? Not that way. Okay, let's try. So going up broader and broader, just a little bit broader and broader, of course. Come on. Very good. And now, very good. And now my question could be, are you going to leave that in one dynamic, or are you going to raise that? What is going with your feeling? Do you think it's becoming bigger? If you think it's becoming bigger, do it bigger. Don't think only that it is bigger, just do it bigger, okay? Can we start once again? Very good, very good, excellent. You have, you know, I used the phrase at the beginning of our meeting that we have many situations where you produce noise between notes. It is not only between notes. On chords, some of chords are not clear. So, you know, I used to tell when you play, my dear, I should be able to write down what you play. So I should be able to recognize C natural, F sharp, La, A, yeah? The next chord, C, La, Re. The next, so it should be very clear served. Can you try to check that? That is a really difficult place, that one, yeah? For clarity. Okay, come on. Very good. And of course, when you will practice that, you will practice that slower without extra time, which you are not going to use afterwards. So with other words, don't practice anything what you don't need. We should always practice the situation, the actual situation in peace. Yeah. Practicing in peace, but in peace. Yeah. Okay, very good. And now let's go, you know, let's go to the beginning of our fantastic fuga. I love that fuga. I love all those three fugas. But I mean, that is such a joy to work on that, and that is such a joy to perform that. So that's why I was a little bit disappointed when I saw you that you have a have a look in the music what you are going to play. Come on, I mean, it's childish. Next time, never again, you know, not from music. We will do that by memory. And now, you know, that is pretty easy. I would like you to serve your, when you are coming to sim, to serve the sim the way that audience would say, oh, wow, I know that. So that would be... So you understand what I mean, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, come on. Very good, very, very good. You know, when you are entering four voices chords, you start with that additional production of sound which doesn't belong there. Because you are, I think you decided that bar, that one, that bar is very difficult. You decided about that. So you have here, oh my gosh, yeah? But I think we can prepare that much, much better. Because you can prepare that. We have two hands. And you know, many people say that one hand goes on automatic pilot. Because we are not able, apparently, as a human beings, to control everything simultaneously. I doubt that. I think we are, maybe not for very long time. But that idea with automatic pilot is not that bad. So in that situation, when you think it is so complicated in left hand, but 300 years ago they played that. Maybe they played arpeggiato. Most likely they played that arpeggiato. So nobody says us that we cannot. We can that play also arpeggiato. But it will be not that much easier because the bow is not very well for the arpeggiato, but doesn't matter. So in this particular case, when you think your left hand takes more of your attention, so you have to be much better with your right hand. But right hand, did you study that right hand for that bar? That is so easy. That's the whole business. And of course, with releasing at the end. To have time to prepare, to anticipate new position. You know the word. Do you understand? Anticipating, it's to, mm-hmm. to be preparing, to be before the time, yeah? Okay, so that would be great if you could do that, you know? Let's go from here. Okay, come on. Very good. Okay. Do you think that something? I think we finished, we arrived some point in the fuga. So, not don't hurry that much. So give me time to take breath, okay? Can we have it once again? And now maybe all those six legati. Come on. Okay, look. Very good, very good. I'm not amazed about quality of those chords after six legato. Can you? And not now that way, you know? A little bit milder, my dear. Okay, come on, once more. Very good. So maybe it was a little bit better, but not that much. You know, when you play, so not like. Of course, we are playing chords, but. Make that a little bit more, you know, more elegant. Not, not, you are not really shooting. I heard that many times, really, on the disgraceful way, but you could do that better. You can do that better, okay? Come on. Go. Okay, my dear. Check your sounding point. I think, I don't see you that well, but I think you are very near to the fingerboard, and that's why it is a lot of noise in between. I would like to have that extremely clear, you know, almost like it would be played on clavichord or organ, doesn't matter. You know, tari, 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 very, very well spoken out. One more time, directly from here. Come on. Now. Yeah, I don't, first third is okay, second, well, acceptable, the third is not good. So you play. Yeah, come on. Okay, so you can work alone on that. So remember, when you practice, try to listen constantly, to listen to yourself, just to be sure that what you wanted to do, that it really happened. Because we are sometimes, you know, in kind of, I don't know, sky or somewhere else, and we think we did that, but how? The question is how. Okay, for the last time. Come on. And go on. Thank you. Very good, very good. And now, you know, as clearer you will play your right hand, as clearer will be your articulation, as clearer you will hear your intonation. Mm-hmm. So, because when you play that very, very clear, so suddenly it is, I cannot say like before, oh, it's foggy. You know, it's a lot of fog, I don't know. Now I know, so some places are not as perfect as they could be, because similar places you are playing absolutely without any problem and very beautiful. So, you know, in a way, if you are able to play one, two bars very beautiful, so it's the question only to put that into bar number three. So then you will have that fuga fantastic, and that is really fantastic piece. So my encouragement is just to make that much, much, much more clear, and to get rid of reading, to have 100% concentration on how I'm playing that. And you know, knowing what you do, not only just, you know, listening and playing three times, five times, and then by time number six, it's better, and we think we did it. No, we did nothing, because we played five times wrong, and the six times was good. So it's less than 20% good, yeah? Something like 16. So, and that will bring you to totally different level of, you know, of communication, because you are communicating with me. And if I don't understand what you say, so you can tell the most, you know, clever sentences in the world, but if I don't understand what you say, it is for nothing. But you are doing that very good, and I'm sure that once we see each other once again, then, or when you play that for another people, that will be even better than today. Okay? Thank you very much, and see you.
Thank you.
Alison.
Thank you, Professor Veng Jin, and thank you, Zomeng. The final student that we'll hear today is fourth year student Sherzod Abdiev. Sherzod will play Simonovsky's Violin Concerto No. 2, accompanied by pianist Ge Xiaozhe. We'll give them some time to get in place.
Of course, I think it's a gift for me. That's fantastic. I'm very happy to be able to talk about that piece. One of most fantastic concertos. That's good that you are doing that. It's not very popular in the repertory. Okay.
Thank you.
Can you hear me? Very good. I hear you very, not very good when you talk. I heard you very well. So bravo, congratulations. So you read that. How long are you playing the piece?
This semester.
Ah, this semester. Okay. So, and tell me, how come, why did you choose that?
I was thinking maybe to attend the Szymanowski competition.
Ah, that's the reason. That's very good reason, by the way. So competitions are not that bad, you see. So sometimes we got an idea to go out from the track of Sibelius and Brahms to another concerto. Very good. So, of course, as a Polish violinist, you know, I love that music. So that is fantastic. I feel that, like I told at the beginning of that, that is kind of gift for me that I can talk with somebody in Singapore about Szymanowski. Right. So, but you yourself, you are from Kazakhstan, I heard, yeah?
No, Uzbekistan.
Uzbekistan.
Yes.
Oh, Uzbekistan. I had students from Uzbekistan. So we are coming from Tashkent, yes?
Yes.
Yeah, great. Okay. So that is also not very familiar to you, that kind of music, is it? Probably not.
Yes.
Yeah. So look, you decided to play that because you will enter Szymanowski competition in Katowice. That's good reason, but how is your preparation to that music? What can you tell us something? You know, we have audience, maybe not very big, but we have some audience, and maybe people don't know anything about that piece, and that it sounds sometimes strange. So tell us, make kind of introduction. What shall we know going to the concert? Or at least, you know, to smell something. What is it about?
This concerto is dedicated to his friend, the Pavel Kochanski. So he helped him to write the cadenza and the violin part, I think, to Szymanowski. And for me, this music is, the beginning is like very, like from far and dreaming. It's molto tranquillo, and then very contrast, and a lot of like active music also going on. With like, for me, I feel it's like folk music motifs, the dancing motifs.
Very good. That's what I was waiting for, you know, because that it's, you know, very lyrical and blah blah blah. That is very, that's true, but it's very much connected to folk's music. Folk music from the mountain area people, so called, I don't know how is it called in English, I think Highlander or something like that, people who live in mountains. Then we have in the south of Poland Tatras, you know, that is pretty high. I mean, not like Alps, but still the highest peak is something like 2,500 meters.
Oh,
and That music comes from that part of Poland. In fact, that is not exclusively only that concerto coming from that part of Poland. His symphonies are connected to that. His very well-known Notturna in Tarantella comes also, is connected to that region and to the folk's music. And that was very specific in those days, because it's the beginning, the not beginning, the first half of 20th century, something like 90 years ago, because the piece is something like 1933, I think 33 or 34, shortly before Kochański died. That was very famous violinist in those days, who was very big friends of Szymanowski. They work together, but that is not, that is a rant, not it is not so important to know the, you know, the relationship Kochański Szymanowski, but that relationship Szymanowski and the folk's music, that is very, very important, because it is in effect not only in Poland going like that. We have another composers like Bartók in Hungary, who took also a lot from Hungarian folk music. We have somebody like Enescu in Romania. So we have a lot of composers getting into the folk music of their own countries and trying to bring that material to classical music. So that's very true. So that would be, of course, good to know something about that for the audience, and good to know what do they expect and why is it sometimes like that. So kind of dissonance music, like that is, you know, those small folks groups out of 3, 4, 5 people maximum, playing, you know, on the street, playing on festins, playing on weddings. So that comes from there. And you know, he had to write that in the conventional way. So it is written with tonality, it is written with key signature, 2/4, it is written with Italian words giving us some information about character, dolcissimo, espressivo, dolce, dolce. So that is not a very big help, the dolcissimo, so espressivo, because we have that everywhere, starting from Schubert, you know, or even earlier, we have those words. But he had to put that because he had, that is the way how to bring our thoughts for next generation. So if you're a writer, you are writing words. If you are a painter, you are putting your paint to the canvas. And when you are a composer, you have to write that song. Later, much later in 50s, composers decided not to be somehow, not to be necessary writing in that conventional way. Why I am talking about that? What do you think? Why I am talking about that he had to put that somehow into the paper?
I think he really wanted to follow, like as a violinist, to follow these indications, these words.
No, we don't understand each other. I'm talking about composer, not about violinist. I'm talking about Szymanowski. And you know, whatever you see in music, it is just an idea, because the conventional language of composing was to write with key signature, with rhythm, with all possible informations. But look, I will give you another example. Maybe that will be helpful. We have that famous phrase of Shakespeare, yeah? To be or not to be? That is the question. So when you see that written, you see just the letters, to be or not to be. This is the question. But how you say that, it is your imagination. You can, first of all, you can put accent to be or not to be. You can put accent to be or not to be. You can put accent to be or not to be, etc., etc. So you can tell that in very, very, very different way. You can make accelerando in phrase, you can make ritenuto, you say to be or not to be, or to be or not to be, that is the question, you know? So that's why I'm talking about that, because the one thing in that music is that it is put into the bars, and that is put into kind of order. But we have much too much order when we play that way. So because in a way that is never-ending coordinated improvisation. So I would like to encourage you, once you know that a little bit better and you can read, get rid of reading music, just to be much more free in there, much more free. So da -di, da -di, da -da -di, da -da. But it's fun, you know, instrumentation, when you play that with orchestra, is just out of that world. I remember when I played that once, and we had already our small son, he was something like maybe 22, maybe 2½, I don't know exactly. And he was sitting with his mother, and she told me afterwards, when orchestra started, she got scared and told me, wow, that is so cruel, you know, the music is coming like from the hell, you know? That is, with orchestra is just, the music is just out of that world. Both concertos, they are totally different, because the first one is a little bit impressionistic, you know, it's totally different, it's not folks music. And that one is, that's his last piece he wrote. So he was very, very mature already, and he came back to that way of writing based on folks music. So, but coming now to our common work, I would like to make you an information about text, because I think you just didn't notice that. You know, when you arrive in shortly before the end, in 51, so that is the second last page on the very bottom.
Yes.
Read what is written there. Subito doppio movimento. So that is on the spot twice faster. So that what we play ta ti da pim pa da ti di, we are not counting anymore in two, we count in one. So that is and that ends up in 56. In 56, you come back to playing in two. That is one thing regarding text. And the second one regarding text, can you play for me just one bar before 44? Excellent, very good. Very good, because when you played first time, you played A natural, not A flat. And I thought maybe you thought it is A natural. Yeah, tari, that is, yeah, no, I mean the sixth last note from D, D, A flat, F. Yeah, very good, that is, okay, very good. So apart of that, I think everything regarding text reading is fine, but now I would like you, you know, to that we just to get maybe a small access into that kind of characteristic music like this one. Before you start, have a look. He writes very often lines over. Usually those are ta di da da 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 di da. When you have those lines, or you have di-da-da-di-da-da-di, remember to take them broad, to take time for those notes, not only for the first one, not ta-da-tin, pa-da-din. So it will come, I think, already on second page, if not on second, no, on third page, several times. That is very characteristic for Szymanowski. So when we start, he writes already here, you know. So feel totally free. Director, orchestra director is for you, not you for you know, for conducting. So that is, yeah, well, I told that already. Think that you improvise, that we have learned improvisation, yeah? But we are free, okay? Come on, beginning. Okay, very good. Thank you very much. So that was already here. Now, those two notes, they have. Yeah, without a good arrangement, of course. Very good, very good. Look, sometimes when you have kind of like you have that, you can show more harmony, you know. But the way you, like you played now, a part of very beginning. So of course we have somehow fit into the orchestra and composer has to fit us. Oh no, Alison, you are already here.
5 minutes, 5 minutes no, left.
No, we are absolutely kidding. We just started to work. Okay, so 5 minutes. I mean, that's ridiculous. Okay, in 5 minutes we can't do anything, you know? So was good. You did that on purpose because I asked for that. It didn't come out of you, but after a while you just fit it into the piece. Okay, so let's start maybe. But clean in bow, my dear. I would like to hear only double stop. Okay, come on. Excellent. I don't know. I tried to animate you to go forward, and then. But remember, he is using sometimes commas. Comma in sentence is just comma. Take a breath. So we have pa-ti-ra-ti-ba-pa-pa-yam-pam-pam. Comma. And then new key. Pam-pam-pa-pa-ri-ra-ri. So. It is, you know, it is never standing. It is almost like concerto number one, where his even very early sonata. We have hardly two bars in same tempo. The music is going all the time like that, all the time, you know, and that makes it so breathtaking from listener. That is better if it is not like a movie. If you don't take public with that, of course you need fantastic conductor, because instrumentation in that concerto is extremely heavy. So to conductor who can keep orchestra really down, giving you place to be as a soloist there, you know, but it is possible. It is possible. Everything is possible. I would like you to start now from molto energico, from those chords, pam, pam, and bring us that moment of taking breath. Okay, come on, go. Thank you. I would like to have very clean chord. Can you play me two first chords only? First is okay. Yeah, second is over four. Yeah. So because you have to change speed of the bow for second chord. Come on. Go on. No, that is not clear. That is not clear. My dear, that is not clear. That is not that. That is the melody. I would like to hear that. And the melodical way with inside dynamic, so micro dynamic. Okay, come on. Now, you know, have a look in your long chords. Your long chords are not, it is not clear that it is, you know, this one is fantastic. It's not enough of G sharp. Yeah, come on. Very good. Very funny. The second group is easier, where you play one half tone lower, and you know, don't press that much. Don't press that much. Practice that mezzo forte for the last time together with piano. Come on, because Alison will switch us off. Come on. Finish here. We finish here in half a minute. You know that whole variation, zita, rapatara, papapam, must be better articulated. You are playing right notes, but you are producing, as I told to your friend before, you are producing too much noise between notes. You know, you have to try to be absolutely, you know, clear, totally clear articulation in bow, and move it. When you feel that music grows, that, you know, because it's windy city, it is wind in Tatras, yeah? So it goes like shh, or coming back, you know, it's slow, and then faster and faster and faster. It's crazy. The music is crazy. So if you are staying, you know, like a civil servant, it will be not crazy. You know, you have to put into that kind of pepper, yeah? Of, you can call it however you want, but move it, okay? And then will come another, you know, another moment where sun is coming out and you can see every mountain, and then you tari, and please rock. That is a little bit too much of chadash, you know, okay? Yeah. So not always with, you can do in both, ways, glissando. So do your glissandi on purpose. If you think you love that, okay. It is not necessary that everybody loves what you love. Then you can do that. But I'm not sure, because I think sometimes we are making decisions out of the moment, not even thinking about, well, okay, so let's go this way. So we shouldn't do that. But you know, the piece is fantastic, and I think that's a really great choice. To prepare the competition, and doesn't matter. Competition is one thing. Competitions are important, but we shouldn't over-evaluate that. But you know, the way to competition, when you now take that concerto and you have, maybe you should have a look, you know, and talk to your school, maybe they would allow you to play that one time at least on rehearsal with orchestra, because it is totally, entirely different world, entirely. So that would be great. And then you have something very, very special. And I'm sure in Tashkent you can play that, because Tashkent orchestras played that. Maybe not very often, but some days that was part of our repertory. Okay, my dear, so I was talking too much. You didn't play enough. Maybe someday, one day in the future, we see each other, maybe not. But anyway, it was great pleasure to work with all of you. And that was a big, big pleasure to speak to you. So, keep going. All the best. See you somewhere. Thank you very much. Bye bye. Alice, thank you very much. You are very patient.
Thank you, Professor Feng Jin. Thank you. And thank you also, Shehzod. We've come to the end of our masterclass, and a tremendous thanks once again to Professor Feng Jin for being with us today to share all your expertise and musical insight with us. Thank you also to our students who played today and for letting us learn with you. We hope that you've enjoyed your time with us here today, ladies and gentlemen, and thank you for joining us for our last virtual masterclass of the semester. You can view the Conservatory's online performance season on our YouTube channel, and for information about our upcoming events and other happenings here at YST, follow us on Facebook and Instagram. Until next time, thank you and have a good evening.